just what kind of things are scientific theories and when should we accept them? The positivists, whether they were verificationists or falsificationists, they all seem to agree that we should accept those theories that were well tested and that passed our tests, especially experimental ones. Where they disagreed, of course, was on their understanding of the nature of those tests, whether they were verifications or falsifications. But can we really place so much emphasis on the reliability of observation? Is observation really so different than the things that we're supposedly testing through observation, our theories? Today we're going to examine that theory-observation distinction, and we're going to look at it through the eyes of some folks who don't think that there really is such a sharp distinction that can be made between the two. And we've been lumping together, even though Popper wouldn't have liked this, but we've lumped together under the heading of positivists, the verificationists and Popper, and the falsificationists. We've done that in large part because they all seemed to think that tests, indeed experimental or observational tests, played a fundamental role in the decision about which scientific theory should be adopted and which not. It's kind of a common sense view, and they tried to explore that and pursue its logic. We ran into trouble with that. It's not that tests aren't important, it's just they're in no way decisive, and indeed with Kuhn we de-emphasize not only questions about observables. They're not nearly so important in Kuhn's story as they were in Popper or in the verificationists. But logic itself isn't nearly as important. Decisions about which theories to adopt are based more on what? How does that go? What problems are deemed most important? Which directions seem most fruitful to pursue? What you're most interested in? But it's not you either. So there's two things that these are sort of code words that we can expand on later. But code words that I want to pull out of Kuhn are these. First of all, decisions about, not I shouldn't say, I guess the word decision isn't the best term to use either, but the issue of which scientific theory will come to dominate a particular field in science, which will be the guiding paradigm for that field in science, is, first of all, more a social matter than an individual matter. I'm not sure that that got brought out nearly as clearly as I wanted to last time, so let me repeat it. It's a social matter among the community of scientists. It's not an individual decision. Indeed, Kuhn argued that as a rule, individuals don't change their minds. People who have been guided all their lives by a particular paradigm more often than not don't change their minds. They continue to be guided by that paradigm. And new paradigms, when they arise in response to whatever situation it is that gives rise to them, some crucial problem that is resisting resolution by the old paradigm, when new paradigms arise, new ideas about how science should be done, new theories, too. When these arise, they're often introduced by younger scientists. They're often accepted by younger scientists, embraced by them. And it's the whole field of work. It might be physics as a whole, but it might be electromagnetic theory. It doesn't have to be physics as a whole. It could be some part of physics. It's the whole field of work that kind of changes. At one point in time, T0, let's call it, it's plain that the textbooks talk a certain way, the guiding paradigm is very clear, virtually all practitioners in the field agree on the basic principles of their discipline. And then at a much later time, let's just say 30 years on down the road, at time T1, why? We look at the textbooks and they are written differently, or the first chapters tell you different things. What attracts students to physics is often a whole different set of problems. Entire different mathematical procedures are necessary for people to practice the discipline. But once again, the textbooks are fairly unanimous, the practitioners are fairly unanimous, and everybody pretty much agrees on what the basic principles of physics are. So what we have here are two distinct periods of what Kuhn calls normal science at T1, or T0 and at T1. But what's happened in between has not been something like the way, it's not like what the textbooks say over here at T1. At T1, the textbooks will tell you about how some crucial experiment was performed and the old theory was decisively refuted, and the community of scientists embraced the new theory and said, Hosanna! praise be the new savior. That's not the way it is at all. Usually there's battles that go on between T0 and T1, in which the very best physicists or practitioners, the people who are the best minds in the discipline, are not in agreement about how one should approach the particular key problems that are at issue. They are not in agreement at all, and they often never come to agreement. We're not talking about dumb old physicists and brilliant young physicists. We're talking about brilliant people on both sides. They don't convince one another. So the decision is not only a social, a non-individual decision, in which what really is the key is how does the whole community of practitioners within that field, how does it move, rather than how does any one person decide. So it's a community thing. We're asking, what happens to physics? Not, you know, Joe Blow the physicist. But by virtue of that fact, the decision is in an important way non-rational. It's if what rationality is thinking things through logically and coming up with some sort of conclusion. What changes things from T0 to T1 is not that. It's not a matter of mustering evidence, because parties on both sides of the argument bring to bear very good evidence, very strong arguments for their sides. And it's not a matter of logic, because logic simply doesn't do the trick. One way of putting this is that neither experimentation nor logic can be decisive, because the answer to which theory should we pursue is a normative theory. The question is not something that can be determined by data, because the data is, to a certain extent, ambiguous in an important way. There will be great successes for both the competing theories that its practitioners can point to, and there will be anomalies, problems for both theories that its enemies can point to. And what needs to be assessed is which, in the long run, not only solves the problems that we've got, because they both solve some problems and they both fail at some, but probably the decision is more like this. Which one looks like it will be the best theory to go with in the long run for the future? When physicists are deciding, if we look at the very key moment when graduate students or even undergraduates who aim to become professional physicists, say, when they decide which graduate school to go to, they got to make a decision in those times of revolution about which approach to the discipline looks most promising. And they make this decision throughout their graduate years as they decide with whom they shall work within a department. Whose approach looks like it's going to be the most promising? This is not something you can know now. That's the decision that has to be made. So people make different decisions. And it's not altogether, again, it's a non-rational decision, because it's not dictated by reason alone. It's a judgment call. It's an estimate. And also, it does have to do, as we suggested, with the decisions about which are the most important problems, because while each of the two competing theories will have its areas of success and its areas of failure, you are likely to go, if you're making one of these decisions, you're likely to go with the theory which seems to you to do the best job on the problems that are most important. And it might be most important personally, most important intellectually in your view, or it might be most important socially, most important given the problems that you think it is that the science is supposed to attend to. But all of these things are not, again, you look at, you can see how squishy this area is. If that's what the decision depends on, then it's not irrational. That's not what we're saying. But it is not something that is dictated by either experimental evidence or by logic. One has to make a judgment. So those are the two, again, I said there were two key slogans, if you like, that I wanted to pull out of Kuhn and into this next episode. One is science is a social enterprise, and decisions about how science shall proceed is a social matter. I shouldn't say it's a social decision, because societies don't decide things. Point is, that's settled by the way the community of scientists happens to move, which way it happens to go. So it's a social enterprise, and for that reason, it is non-rational. And please distinguish that. If it's not clear to you, let me know. That's not to say it's irrational, anti-rational. It's not that. It's just not rational. Any questions? You got that distinction between non-rational and irrational? Science is superior in some respects to non-science, to philosophy, just because it gets back to these paradigms. So science working like this, in this particular institutional way, is not a dumb thing. There's nothing irrational about it.
Sense of aesthetics plays a role in this decision process.
Kuhn would. I mean, aesthetics is, I mean, and again, the elegance of a particular theory may be just the sort of thing that attracts someone to it. And elegance might be thought, I mean, I don't know if you're acquainted with this term, but mathematicians use the term all the time. A solution is elegant if it satisfies certain criteria. It's sloppy and inelegant. For example, if you answer all your questions, but you got 67,000 answers and there's no structure to it, no theme, no way of tying it all in together. But your point that the decision about which theory to accept, which theory to go with, again, if it's not a decision that's made by individuals so much as it is a growing tendency within a community of practitioners, it may be that aesthetic considerations, it has been argued that those play a not insignificant role. Pardon? That Kuhn would, that was actually Carl's point, but Kuhn has made that point too. Kuhn would point, and that's part of what he means by non-rational. It's for reasons other than straightforwardly logical reasons that we make that this happens, and aesthetic considerations would then fall into the realm of non-rational, although not irrational either, just irrational, if you like, factors that lead to movement in science from one paradigm to the next. Now, I want to get back to the contrast between, that's a way of making the contrast between the positivists or empiricists, depending on who you talk to, but all of those are to be lumped into the same crowd for present purposes, positivists and empiricists, how they differ from Kuhn. That's one way of telling the story. There's another way of telling the story that plays on some of these things. It has to do with an important distinction between, or alleged distinction between, theory and observation. Okay. For the positivists generally, the test of a theory is whether it can, it is borne out under the scrutiny of experimental tests, of observations. So that theories stand or fall depending on how observations go. And while none of those positivists, neither the verificationists nor the falsificationists, were quite as naive as sometimes their critics make them out to be, and that things are never as simple as you hear in a philosophy course, because You know, there's a tendency to keep talking about things in terms of isms, and no individual person really is completely embraced by any of these isms any more than any of you are encompassed by liberal, conservative, Democrat, Republican. I mean, these labels almost never capture anybody completely. They're fuzzy at their edges. Individual people are much more complex in the way that they think about things. Same with philosophers. Nonetheless, the general tendency was among the empiricists, among the people who thought of the testability of a theory as the key to whether it was, you know, could even qualify as scientific. There seemed to be some idea that observation was, more reliable than theory. I mean, you don't test observation, after all, by checking it against theory, according to these people. It's the other way around. Theory, and I think to this day, common sense use of the term theory suggests it's kind of tentative, hypothetical. Observation is as plain as the nose on your face. So observation is taken to be more reliable than theory. And so therefore provides us, again, this is something of a simplification of the review, but observation seems among the positivists to provide us with kind of direct access to reality, where theory gives us a more indirect access, and so we have to test it against observation. One way of understanding the difference between these empiricists and people like Kuhn, who I'm now going to lump together in a group, this is Boyd's term, but I'm going to lump them together with a few other, lump Kuhn together with N.R. Hansen and a few other people and call him a social constructivist. Another way of understanding the difference between the empiricists and Kuhn is in terms of their conception of theory and observation. Hansen, I believe, is the person who's responsible for this expression, but the theme for today, more than any other, is going to be this: the theory ladenness of observation. One reason, in brief, to reject all of these positivistic views of science is that they are not sustainable. They're not sustainable because they seem to rely on the idea that observation is some kind of a neutral court in which theories can be judged as to their virtues. What Hansen and Kuhn argue with rather substantial persuasiveness, they've certainly persuaded a lot of people, is that no such sharp distinction can be made. Observation is theory-laden. Observation is never neutral as regards theory. Now, it's first advanced here, and that's why we're bringing it out here, as a thesis about scientific theories. And often the scientific evidence for the theory-ladenness of observation is pretty straightforward. They'll say, now look what you do when you perform a scientific experiment. I mean, imagine some experiments done on the super collider. This is an elaborate piece of equipment. I mean, no layperson can understand what's going on. A layperson walks in there and is, let's say if you or I were told, let's go in there and make some observations. I mean, your observations would be like, boy, what a big piece of machinery. You wouldn't be able to make observations of the kind that scientists make. You need to be trained for a jillion years to make observations on pieces of equipment like that. And in particular, you have to be trained in the theory that explains how this equipment works and what it is that it's telling you. It's difficult enough to see anything in a very powerful microscope if you're not trained. It's especially difficult, I don't know if you ever looked into an electron microscope, but it doesn't really look particularly determinate. Its working depend on an elaborate scientific theory. The way it works, the way it's designed, same with almost any other piece of equipment in science. An observation is, even a simple one, like determining the acidity of a liquid. What do? What's the simplest test for that? Take a piece of litmus paper and drop it in. And if it turns a particular color, you report the results of your observation. You might report turned blue or turned pink. But mostly, you probably report, is acidic, as if you'd observed that. All you've observed is the color of a little piece of paper. That color indicates whether it's an acid or a base. That depends on theory. And so these examples, when they're brought up in connection with science, are plausible enough because it's pretty plain that almost any observation that counts, that makes any difference in science, depends heavily on theory. And often when scientific discoveries are made, it's just for the reasons like the little story I told you about the stellar parallax. It turns out that the reason that an observation is purportedly made, but the reason that it doesn't mean what people thought it meant is because of some theoretical assumption someplace else in the network of assumptions they're making, auxiliary assumptions, background assumptions. Something back there is not correct. So what you get, what you decide about a theory, whether it has passed the test of an experiment or failed, certainly depends on other theory. But the key here is even deeper. It says observation itself, especially this step one, observations in modern scientific experiments are not neutral with regard to theory. They are dependent upon theory. I want to argue that we're actually at the edge of metaphysics here. This isn't just a theory about science. This thesis of the theory-ladenness of observation. It's a thesis that cuts deeper than that. And so at this particular juncture, we are in an area where the theorists tend to differ about how they understand reality itself and our relationship to it. So I want to spend a little bit more time. I want to begin with something that we talked about a bit before, this box. Remember, this was supposed to be an illustration of the way that you could look at the same thing in two different ways. If I ask you which one is right, the perspective that has this face is the front face or that one is the front face, I mean, everybody recognizes that's a dumb question. Let me see. I'm not sure I can do this, but let me see for a moment. I try this every time I work with this example. If I can possibly, without touching that box, give you reasons to prefer that was the best tree I ever drew, one scheme over another. I'm not sure whether I can. Keep trying to look at that box both ways. Have I picked out one over the other as preferable? I mean, you can look at it, but some of you are saying yes. Look at it carefully and decide for yourself which way is preferred, because I just really like to take a poll here. I believe that I have, I mean, I may be wrong. It might be, again, it's hard for me to be sure of this. I think I've picked out one of the perspectives as preferable without touching the box. Now, you know what, if you think I'm right, identify for yourself which one it is. Is the view that has this face in the front the one that's more preferable? How many think so? Is the other one more preferable? How many think so? How many think they continue to be equally fine? Okay, good. I'm glad. All right. I thought I was making the one that you all identified as preferable. I thought I was making that the preferred face, preferred front face, just by constructing the background in a certain way. Now, if I had done that in a way that was more sensitive to perspectival drawing, I think I probably could have convinced every single one of you. But the point here is that while if I just said which is the right view of that box, you might say, well, that's a silly question. If I put that box in a scene or give it a background, then there might seem to be an answer to the question, which one is best? And that's not just a matter that involves science and theorizing and the relationship of scientific theory to observation. Inuit Indians, Indians of the north, the northern part of the world, those people have something like, and I've heard all kinds of numbers here, 13 is the one that I've heard most often, 13 different words for what is falling, actually probably not true, for what we would describe as snow. I don't know what particular one among those words would describe the stuff that's falling outside, but it probably is different. Here's one of the distinctions that might be made. It's probably, that stuff out there is pretty dry, cold, but you know, like when it falls down and it's about 32 degrees and it's snowing and it's wet and heavy, that's probably got a different word in the Inuit languages. And they distinguish between snow that would be good for making igloos, I take it. I mean, I don't know about the detail of any of this, but the distinctions among these 13 different words for what we would call snow are between things that are good for making igloos, things that are good for supporting a sled, things that might be a likely place where you could break into the ice and catch fish. I mean, you know, what they're distinguishing is stuff that's really out there. But there's two theses. First of all, the simple one, the uncontroversial one, is that our language doesn't accommodate all these distinctions.
I disagree.
About what?
That our language doesn't accommodate different types of snow. I think that we have tons of...
Skier?
Yeah.
Give me some.
Sleet. Grapple is a term for like little hard balls.
Mm-hmm. Corn snow.
Corn snow. Yeah, just there's tons, slush, anything. There's tons of words.
All right. Doesn't hurt my main thesis. In fact, I think that might provide some support to it in the end. But what I want to suggest is that for those people like me who aren't out there in the snow and who don't do any skiing, and I was raised in the city of Chicago, and I would love to fly down the slopes the way I see some people doing it, I'm not prepared to go through whatever work it takes to get there. So I mean, I've never, so I don't have any pressing desire to go out there and learn. My understanding of the English language did include sleet, that falls on me from time to time, but not grapple. There may be many, many others. Indeed, some of them may be derived, for all I know, from the Inuit languages. Probably not?
Probably not. Most of it, I think, would be...
Just made up by people?
Just like the community of skiers, I think. Inuits...
It's just new? I mean, how long... Because people have been skiing for...
Oh, well, yeah. I would say that they're a community of skiers in the United States more that we use. Terms.
Grapple is not a term that would be used by alpine skiers.
That may be a term that came over from, like, Germany or something.
Let us take me as the example. You're a skier.
Right.
Not you, but take me as the example and have me stand next to the Inuit in a field of white stuff up there close to the North Pole. And we look around and let's say a third party asks us to describe what we see. And I'll say, snow. Let me make this case. That word, now I'm not absolutely certain that this is true. I believe it's true. That word snow, that generic term, may have no equivalent to the Inuit Indians. It's about as useful to them as stuff. I mean, they may have a word like stuff, but they wouldn't need a special word that covers all these different kinds of snow, because that's about all there is around there. But if we were standing and looking at the scene and a third party asked us to report and to describe what we saw, I'd say snow. And the Inuit would probably say, oh, well, there's some... this Glogalok over there, and the Mugamuk over there, and the Phenobarbital, that's their name. No, they describe the several different things that they saw in their vicinity. And if I were with a skier, same situation might arise. And I don't know whether the skiers would have as many distinctions to be drawn or more. I don't think it's much a question of numbers here. What's crucial is that if we add, now to bring this back to the block situation, if I asked you now to make a judgment about who's right, What would you say? Is the skier right, or the Inuit, or am I right about what I see? It sounds like another dumb question, right? it's not a question of right and wrong. I think everybody will probably leap to the idea that, well, it has something to do with the usefulness in varying contexts. Like, I don't, you know, being born and raised in Chicago, I don't particularly need to make all these distinctions. Some of them might be useful. Slush is one I make, but that's like dirt and snow. Sleet is one a distinguishing term I make, but that's kind of rain and snow. But I suppose all the other ones are kind of like that, too. They have to do with, relations of the stuff described to activities or to or something else. What we could see is that, the Inuit language, not just this particular individual, because if this individual were taken out of that culture and raised in Chicago, person would no more be able to distinguish all these wonderful things than I am. But given the context, it's useful for that culture to have a language that makes all of these distinctions. Call these things not just languages, though, but conceptual schemes. Because when I am asked to identify anything new, I am going to see it, understand it, and relate it to the things that are in my experience. I'm going to try and fit it into that array of descriptive terms, I might say, or concepts, if I'm talking mentally, that is mine. So whenever I encounter something new, when I make an observation of something that I haven't seen before, I'll try and fit it in, saying, well, it's like this, or it's like that. And what I'll try and do is to fit it into that conceptual scheme that I've got. Not without expansion. I'm not saying that you can't experience something new. It's quite the opposite. I'm saying that in order to experience something new, you have to figure out, just sort of where anyway it has its newness. It's sort of like this, but different in some respect. It's sort of like this, but then where most thises have a certain characteristic, this one doesn't, it's more like that. That's how we recognize things. That's how we understand things. And so it's not just a box and not just snow, and it's probably not simply language if we mean noises that come out of people's mouths or things that they jot down on a piece of paper. It goes as deep as concepts and ways of looking at the world. And the point here is, A, there are different ones of these, and I've been illustrating non-scientific examples that differ from culture to culture, but they may very well differ from individual to individual within a culture, depending on the different experiences that individuals have. They certainly may differ from time to time in the life of any culture. It may be that at some certain periods of its history, people characteristically understood phenomena. It's almost certainly the case that in some periods of its history, people understand their world radically differently. They have different conceptual schemes, different whole ways of looking at things. And if you were to ask which one is right, you would be asking a question that's as senseless as saying which of these cubes is correct. I mean, which one of those perspectives on the cube is correct? What might make sense is which one is best under certain circumstances, which one serves certain needs best. When you have the impression that something is completely alien, completely different, unlike anything, I mean, I have questions about whether you could really even experience such a thing, but because at least it's got a, it's got a fact, it has to have these similarities. It's got to stimulate one of your receptor organs in order to be experienced. But so at least it has to have that. It looked, it doesn't, may not look like a bunch of anything else. It's got to look. It's got to have a color. It's got to have some shape if it's visible at all. Okay, so it has to have some resemblances. As I say, I question whether you can really experience anything that's totally 100% alien. But imagine it to be as alien as possible. In those cases where we have experiences like that, we are simply at a loss. We cannot describe it. And indeed, psychologically, I bet it can be documented. I'm pretty confident that this is the case. I haven't got the documentation in hand. That's why I'm a little reticent about saying this. But I bet you'll find that people will begin to doubt their experiences when they are so alien as not to, fit very well at all into schemes. They'll wonder, did that really happen? Just because it's so weird. And they will doubt themselves. They will especially doubt themselves if other people keep telling them, no, that couldn't have happened. Right. So in a lot of cases, that's exactly what you're doing. Observations might very well, in those kinds of cases, be checked against your background assumptions, what you assume to be possible, what your theory of the world. Now, we're not talking about science here, although it has important ramifications for science. What your theory of the world says is even possible will determine what you're prepared to accept as a possible observation. That's exactly what's going on when you tell your physics professor, hey, I just undermined the general theory of relativity in an experiment over here. And your professor will say quite reasonably, quite rightly, no, you haven't. Although, of course, it's possible that you did. But it's real unlikely. Real unlikely. There is a clear-cut kind of case where we check our the credence we give in observations and observation sentences as a function of underlying theory. All of this suggests to people like Kuhn and Hansen that the whole empiricist program has got a problem. It seems to imagine that we have this relatively incorrigible access to the world through observation, and that we kind of receive data from the world through our senses. And that then, in order to try to explain this data that is there, that is undoubtable, that is plain on its face, then we do something cognitively to try to explain it. What this whole story about the theory-ladenness of observation suggests is something different. This isn't a new story. It goes back at least to Kant, a German philosopher in the late 18th, early 19th century. But the idea is our very observations are colored by the way we look at things. What we will see depends in large part upon our expectation. A psychological phenomenon known for some years among psychologists is called perceptual readiness. You see what you expect. It's hard to see the things that you don't expect. There's all kinds of experiments that document this. Let's see if I can get this one right. A real fun one that I've actually participated in involves decks of cards. Is this, do you have another one?
We'll get
Let me do mine if it's different. The one with the decks of cards is that the subjects, usually students, I mean, who are hard up for funds because the psychology departments will pay for these things, usually through NSF grants, so it's taxpayers in the end that pay for these things. But, you know, like that's how it went at Purdue University. That's where I, you know, participate in a lot of these experiments because you got a little money for them. But in any case, you know, the decks of cards were fixed up so that, what do you have? You've got clubs, right? I guess you got hearts. You've got spades, and you got diamonds. These are red, characteristically. These are black, characteristically. Okay. Now, what they did, I guess they probably showed this on a slide projector, color slide projector, so it could be shown to a room full of people in a fairly controlled way. They rigged this up. Some of these things were black. There are black hearts in the deck, and there were red clubs, okay? And what they would do is they would show people these things. You know, they would go through the deck and show it to them. People would see, for example, if shown that, sometimes they would see, I don't know, I think they may never see a diamond with that. They might see, if this one were red, they might call it a diamond. If this one is red, they'd call it a heart, and vice versa. You know, there's some similarities in the shapes there. but they would never, they would not notice. I mean, and this could, you know, if you showed them, if you sat it there and showed it to them for an hour, I suppose maybe they'd notice it. But you could play them in a remarkably slow progression, and they wouldn't pick it up. They'd just get confused. They'd say, club. They'd you know, they'd make their judgments more slowly. But they wouldn't say, that's a red club. They wouldn't say that. They couldn't see that. I mean, it was, you know, like, they were just, and no one told them there wasn't going to be like that. So it's not just science and stuff that proceeds in this way. Our very perceptions involve expectations. And it's a phenomenon that's been known for quite a while in psychology, again, called perceptual readiness. And that's about all there is to this whole notion of the theory ladenness of observation. Although that second expression, the theory ladenness of observation, illustrates how this psychological phenomenon pervades science. Observation isn't neutral. Indeed, if you think about the development of children, it makes sense to imagine that little kids may not see things as such, possibly. They learn what boundaries in their perceptual field to take as significant and as meaningful and which ones not. And they learn this as a function of, I guess, their activities in their environment. The thing I want to lead up to here is this. This whole notion, the whole notion of the theory ladenness of observation undermines radically the empiricist program, which imagined that we take our theories into experiments and we decide what theory to accept on the basis of the way observations go. Because that would be a circular method of reasoning if the observations themselves were not neutral, but were themselves the, you know, if they themselves depended upon some theory or another, some way of looking at the world, some conceptual scheme. Okay, and what Kuhn and Hansen in particular argue is that the theories we bring to perception are really social constructions. They are constructions, they are literal social constructions when we're talking about natural languages like the Inuit Indians, or when we're talking about languages even of special groups in our culture, special professions, special groups of sportsmen. They develop jargon and terminology that can be as old as you please. It's just the way language works, but they would develop jargon and terminology that fits their needs. But that's it, they develop it. They develop a scheme for parsing the world in ways that are useful. And then it's that scheme that they bring into the world in an observation. So theories, or even conceptual schemes, not just in science, according to Kuhn and Hansen, are social constructions. They are conventions. Now, you can take two attitudes toward this. Let's just look at this in a kind of a simplistic way, this whole story between the empiricists and Kuhn. It's going to lead on to people like Boyd, who think of themselves not as social constructivists, but as realists. But what happened with the empiricist tradition is that they more or less had they'd sort of evolved this way. They started out with this this impression, this intuition, that observation gives us an access to reality that is special access, and that theory is somehow indirect. They distinguished between observables, stuff that really could be seen, heard, tasted, or felt, and on the other hand, unobservables, stuff like atoms. And as I've mentioned, among the positivists were people like Ernst Mach, who I think his name came up in one of the earlier lectures. Ernst Mach is one who was as fine a scientist, as fine a physicist as you could imagine. Ernst Mach was extraordinarily influential in the development of Albert Einstein, since his name came up. Ernst Mach as I say, was no philosopher on the outside, but Ernst Mach thought that the atomic theory was extraordinarily useful and should be embraced and adopted by physicists because of its usefulness in tying together broad ranges of data. But he didn't think we should believe for a second that there were any such things as atoms. That was just linguistic. He said, that's just a way of talking. It's just it's a device. This whole theory is an intellectual device. It's a model, if that helps, that helps us to visualize, helps us to gather together all these different considerations in one place. But we shouldn't take it any more seriously than we take the cockles on the heart. So empiricists had the tendency to be realists about the world of observables and conventionalists or instrumentalists about theory. When pressed, they often got a bit uncomfortable because words like ugluck or sleet did seem to say or to suggest or to imply, since they were class terms, they said more, they talked about more, they referred to more than just a particular observation event. I mean, a particular observation event might be the description of patches of color, for example. And so empiricists began to talk like that. They began to talk about how, all right, the real observations are in terms of sense data. And then if we attach a term or a word to it, then we're already doing some organizing. And so even, you know, the normal natural language terms for things are already a little bit removed from observation. There's a little bit of theory packed into those. But still, they said, there's this raw data, this raw sense data that's incorrigible. Or at least that's reality. That's reality talking to us. Here's a good reason for being a little bit suspicious about that. Any organism's sense data cater to the needs of that organism. We don't pick up any old data out there in the world. We pick up data in a certain range. And the data that we pick up, presumably, and the presumption I'm making is evolutionary theory, presuming evolutionary theory to be correct, the reason we don't get stuff in the ultraviolet and the infrared visually is because that stuff isn't nearly as vital in contributing to the survival of creatures like us to the age of procreation as is the stuff in the range between, in the visual part of the electromagnetic spectrum, and similar for the other senses. So that what we do is we, as organisms now, forget about conception now, but our sense data themselves kind of filter out irrelevancies. I often think it's at least illuminating to imagine the sense organs to be even more important in filtering out irrelevant data than they are as emitters of important data. I mean, because if you could imagine organisms trying to adjust to all the data there is, I mean, if we had, impossible to imagine, but if we had sense organs that communicated to us all the different sorts of things, and, you know, just even in the whole electromagnetic spectrum, that might be confusing enough and occupy our attention enough, or at least occupy brain space enough, as to be counterproductive in terms of our survival. So as important, again, one can make too much of this, but as important in understanding the senses is understanding their role as filters, devices that keep stuff out that we don't want to be bothered with. That's as important a function as the function of letting in that data that we do want to be bothered with. But that means that the very perceptions, the very sensations that we have has to do, to a certain extent, with the equipment we bring to the situation. Has to do with those filtering devices that we bring into that world. We pick out, just as organisms, not deliberately, this isn't a conscious matter at all, but biologically speaking, we pick out the stuff that we're to see. We bring, that's a kind of perceptual readiness as well. There's a sense in which observation is a function of our needs and expectations, even at that sensory level. So they kind of got driven back to the wall. The social constructivists argue Forget about this distinction between theory and observation. You don't need it. But what that yields is a picture of reality itself that's conventional. Reality itself is a social construction. Not just scientific theory. That's a special kind of social construction among scientific theorists, among scientists. It's that community that constructs scientific theories. But here's the way in which this is a metaphysical thesis. The world, or worlds that we live in, are constructed by us. They are our constructions. They have to do with our needs, expectations, our ways of parsing them. The social constructivists argue that our scientific theory should be understood as things we invent, mere social constructions. This is not a universally agreed upon view among philosophers of science, and we'll see some alternatives next time. Thank you.